mindfulness has been around, as we know, for centuries. So the longest view backwards is to take us back into the ancient traditions of Asia and to Gautama, to the Buddha, as he became known very commonly, and to Buddhism, which, as John Peacock is fond of saying, a teacher of ours, Buddhism means wake-up-ism. And so the theme of Buddhism is to wake up. And it started 2,500 years ago with what we might now call a secular practice, with a master and a few disciples teaching something rather in as an alternative to the what you might now call it, the religious culture of the day. The sense of nobility was being born into a certain class of priesthood, rather than, as the Buddha said, nobility being how you lived, how you practiced, not how you were born. And the sense of a master and disciples, of course, as the word spread and the practice spread, it got incorporated into the what we might now call the faith traditions, the religions of the time. But the original practice was about waking up, seeing clearly. And critical to this was a word, sati, which occurs again and again in these ancient texts, which has been translated mindfulness or awareness, a sense of waking up to what's happening moment by moment in the outside world and in inside world. It not just seeing clearly, but also incorporating the sense of appreciating. A lucid understanding or lucid awareness and an appreciative awareness of what's happening. And what seems to have inspired people today is not just the idea of waking up and smelling the coffee, though that's nice, but that just remains an idea. And as we know, most ideas are things that are easily forgotten. Most resolutions, indeed, are easily forgotten. You can go into shops now and you can buy a poster, wake up and smell the coffee. But after you've hung it on your wall, 2 or 3 days later, you don't notice the poster anymore, never mind the coffee. So what seems to attract people about mindfulness is not that it's an idea, I'll wake up, but a practice, something that we can practice often enough to become skilled in waking up. I think it's worth saying, even at the beginning, that in our research, we've never claimed that mindfulness was a panacea, but somehow it escaped the clinic and the research lab into society, where people have made very big claims for mindfulness. And it's lovely to see enthusiasm, but it bites back sometimes. And some people feel that they need to really undermine the enthusiasm by saying that mindfulness is very dangerous. Mindfulness is neither a panacea, nor, I think, very dangerous, so long as we take care and wake up to what we're doing as we're doing it. But this 2,500-year-old tradition, which Chris Cullen and I will explore in greater detail tomorrow, is just the background to a much more recent history of the application of mindfulness in contemporary society. And that, of course, and you might call it the second tributary to the river of contemporary mindfulness, was John Kabat-Zinn's work in UMass Medical Center. So he was inspired to set up a clinic, a stress clinic, a stress reduction clinic, in the middle of the UMass Medical Center at General Hospital. And he invited doctors to refer any patients that they couldn't do anything more with. And he ended up with classes of 30 or more of people, many of whom had chronic pain and chronic physical conditions. And he opened this clinic in 1979. And the clinic was to teach people mindfulness. He had developed an 8-week program, which later became known as mindfulness-based stress reduction. 2.5 hours a week for 8 weeks. This week, if you're new to mindfulness, you'll hear people talking about the 8-week program quite a lot. And so I ought to explain that when people talk about the 8-week program, they usually mean either MBSR or the MBCT or one of the mindfulness-based interventions, usually taught as a class with homework in between, or home practice in between. Now, you may think that that was a very odd thing to do, to train people who had chronic physical conditions how to wake up, to become more aware. If mindfulness means awareness, then it's a very strange thing to train people who are already so aware of their pain that it's really getting them down, to train them to become more aware. And actually, we often lose that sense of paradox when we realize actually what was being done. Worse than that, he told them that he wasn't going to get rid of their pain. But they came anyway. What John had realized was that pain that's all-consuming is both intense sensations and very uncomfortable sensations, but that relatively early on for any of us when we have discomfort, what happens are thoughts and feelings understandably grow up around those sensations, which become fused, almost fused together into one very difficult and hopeless entangled mess. And often the thoughts are things like, my life has been irreversibly damaged, or I'll never be able to enjoy life again. Frustration, hopelessness, despair, all become fused together around the sensations, so much so that you can't actually see any difference between them. It's just occupies all the space in your head and all the space in your life. And John's intuition was, and indeed most of the psychological procedures for helping people with pain when people got to the end of their medical treatment, most of the psychological procedures in those days was based on distraction. And distraction works not bad, actually. There was evidence that it worked, but it was about distraction from the pain. That seemed really wise and sensible. It didn't seem wise and sensible to make people focus on their body, for goodness sake. Right in session one, the body scan. But John's intuition, based on his own practice of mindfulness, was that those intense sensations that give rise to chronic pain and all the thoughts and feelings around them are held in place. They become stuck by processes of which we're not aware. And they're automatic processes, and that is what you shine the light of awareness on. It's the processes that maintain, that get you stuck in whatever is creating the disturbance. And so he had this 8-week program. People discovered that beginning to uncouple the thoughts and feelings from the sensations, bringing awareness to to the body having the courage to bring awareness to the body and to those thoughts and feelings, gradually this big black blob, as it were, would begin to float apart into its constituent parts. And somehow, this uncoupling gave just a sense of a little bit of freedom, a little bit of the possibility that these sensations, although they might still exist, could be, as it were, in the corner of the room instead of occupying the whole room. Now, he'd been trained as a, John Kabat-Zinn, been trained as a molecular biologist, so he was really keen to write up his results. They were published during the 1980s, and I guess if he hadn't published them and started giving workshops about this work, we certainly wouldn't have come across his work. But it was in the early 1990s when John Teasdale, Zindel Siegel, and I started getting together, called together actually by Zindel Siegel, because Zindel had received a MacArthur Foundation award of, I think it was $20,000, Zindel, something like that, to develop a way of trying to prevent depression, a cognitive therapy. And it was imagined that what we three would do would be to develop cognitive therapy maintenance, CBTM, because other psychotherapies had got a maintenance form and seemed to do well in reducing relapse in depression. Why were we concerned about depression? Because depression is one of the biggest burdens known right across the world. This is not just a burden in terms of disability compared with other mental health issues, also compared with physical health issues. It takes people down more often than most physical and mental health conditions, creating the conditions under which people can't function, can't work, can't earn a living. And once you've been depressed once, data from the 1980s was beginning to suggest that in many people it would come back. And once it had come back twice or three times, it would be a recurrent problem. Early on in the 20th century, it appeared that depression didn't start until middle age or late middle age. But by the end of the 20th century, a new pattern was emerging, that depression started, well, in our research, it was the mid-20s. Now the data suggest that depression starts in mid-teens. And the most common age of onset of serious clinical depression is now between 13 and 15 years of age. So here you have a recurrent problem which can be reactivated and rekindled throughout a whole lifetime that starts young. 75% of people who are ever going to get depressed have been depressed by the age of 24. It's a huge implication for workplaces, for colleges, when students come to college or come to workplaces and find new places, new colleges, new workplaces, rekindle an old depression. And workplaces and know this a lot. And depression can affect your memory, and it can become chronic. So it's a big burden. So that's why the MacArthur Foundation had asked Zindel to come up with a maintenance form of cognitive therapy. We had met, I think, a couple of times in 1992, even drafted what should be in a maintenance form of cognitive therapy, when John Teasdale suggested that we might look at the work of somebody called John Kabat-Zinn. I still, to this day, I think have a piece of scrappy paper in which I'd written the name, spelling John wrong, J-O-H-N Kabat-Zinn, ? Down in the corner of the page. John Teasdale explained to Zindel and to me that he'd been doing work in something called mindfulness, a very interesting work on chronic pain, and we should check it out. Well, we did. We checked it out by going round to the corner, round to the Cavendish bookshop, I think it was, in Toronto, where we were meeting, and buying three copies of a new book called Full Catastrophe Living that had come out a couple of years before. And we spent the afternoon dipping into the book. I couldn't read the whole book in an afternoon. But, you know, clinical psychologists, speed reading. You've got 3 hours to read this book and memorize it. What we noticed there, as three cognitive scientists and cognitive therapists, was there was enough in this book to reassure us that John Kabat-Zinn was really a cognitive therapist, but he hadn't really realized it yet. So we thought it was safe to go and meet him and to, well, learn what he was doing and see what it might do for our cognitive therapy. We thought we might put some meditations into our CBTM. And that's sort of what we did. We sort of tried to see what he was doing. We sat in on his first class. We looked to see what he was doing. We certainly were impressed that he had 35 people in a room. We thought, well, depression, the scale of the problem, needs this sort of class-based or group-based approach. And we started trying to incorporate it into our CBTM. And, well, you know from the books that in the end, when we tried that with our patients, they sort of got it. But we came up against problems that we seemed to be pulling in two directions between a mode of mind which was trying to help people solve their problems and a mode of mind which seemed to allow or suggest or invite people to perhaps just watch their thoughts coming and going, not trying to challenge them or seek the evidence for and against. Nevertheless, these seem to be getting to a cognitive common root of what others in the cognitive science field, including Zindel in a paper the previous year, had called decentering. Decentering. The ability to somehow stand back without running away. The ability to stand back enough so you can move in close to your phenomena without getting stuck to them. That what John and his colleagues were teaching was something which got to the same place, perhaps, that cognitive therapy had got to, but in different ways. And it's worth saying, I think, that one of our interests in seeing whether there were other ways to get to the same place was the evidence that cognitive therapy, when offered to people when they're depressed, both could help reduce the symptoms of depression as well as anything else, but also protect against relapse. Cognitive therapy, when offered to people who are depressed right now, both reduces depression and protects against relapse. It's worth saying that because it shows that mindfulness-based cognitive therapy came in part out of the success of cognitive therapy, not its failure. It wasn't that we're trying to get elbow cognitive therapy out of the way. We're trying to learn from how cognitive therapy had its prophylactic effects and to see, could we understand them deeply enough to teach those skills to people even when they weren't depressed? Cognitive therapy needs people to be depressed. It's premised on getting activity starting again, examining negative thinking, through doing experiments, behavioral experiments during the week, and coming back and sharing that, the results of those experiments, with a therapist. And in that way, people begin to test and see their ideas as hypotheses rather than the truth. How could we do that with people who are well right now? That's what Kabat-Zinn had been doing. John had been teaching his patients to see their thoughts, even the trivial ones, as thoughts. And as you know, as you might have discovered this morning, you don't have to sit for very many seconds before your mind begins to do something more interesting than sitting in Oxford. It might do something interesting, like reminding you of an email that you'd meant to send, or reminding you you haven't switched off your phone yet and hoping it won't ring. The mind has all sorts of things that it brings you, like a puppy bringing you your slippers, and therefore you get from the right at the get-go, right at the start, you get lots of practice at seeing thinking happening, restlessness happening, boredom happening. And so lots of opportunity to practice working with what we might call mind states or mooded mind states. Mind states that come in depression rather like what John had described for chronic pain, clusters of moods, thoughts, body sensations, impulses to act. And in that cluster is the heaviness, the reactivity. And this can all be practiced even if there aren't big moods around. Well, with John's help, we developed an 8-week program using many of the core practices that he had developed and used and found effective in UMass. But after the first session, changing each session in small but important ways to address the needs of our vulnerable patients. So session 2, session 3, session 4, right up to session 8, has some very great similarities with MBSR, but no session is the same as MBSR. But they differ in subtle ways that are addressing the particular concerns of the pathology of depression. The first trial of whether this was effective at preventing a new episode was published in the year 2000. And there are some systems out there in ether that keep reminding me that this is the top 1% cited papers in my field. I don't know how they define my field, but it became very highly cited. Despite the fact it was quite a small trial, but it got significant results, especially it was found for people with the longest histories with the most episodes of depression. They seemed to respond best. That was replicated a few years later by John Teasdale and Helen Ma, who's now in Hong Kong. And the same pattern of people, everybody had to have at least 2 episodes to get into that trial, but they were stratified. So the people with only 2 episodes were in, as it were, randomly allocated to receive mindfulness separately from people with 3 or more episodes, who were randomly allocated either achieve mindfulness or treatment as usual. And for people with 3 or more episodes, it seemed to work very well. So the 8-week program of what's now called mindfulness-based cognitive therapy came into being. Week by week, people are invited to do a meditation which helps them attend to the mode of mind that they're bringing to situations. There's nothing you can do about things happening in the world. There's nothing you can do about things occurring in your moods and in your mind. But what happens next turns out to be really important, and there is a chance that one can begin to do something about, to relate differently to what happens, what comes up and what happens, this mode of mind. In the books and the papers, you'll see how that is developed, how the problem-solving mode of mind starts to volunteer for a job that it can't do. We call it the doing mode, or more recently, the driven doing mode. Some people might call it means-ends thinking, means ends thinking, the idea of thinking, but also always thinking, what's my goal here? And because that means ends thinking or problem-solving mode is so useful for most of our lives, like getting to the town hall this morning, you need to know where you are now and what your destination is and what roads to avoid where there might be roadworks. You've got to anchor that sense of where you are now and how much distance is left to travel to your destination. And that's how GPS works. I mean, sat-nav. Sat-nav wants to know always your current location. In fact, every app on your phone wants to know your current location, if you haven't realized. Just us here, somebody up there knows that we're all in the same current location. Google knows, certainly. But in a sat-nav or a GPS, also you put in your destination. And the clever GPSs will already know where the traffic is that it helps you avoid. Recalculating, it says on my system. Recalculating the route because of traffic problems. It does that all the time on some journeys. But a sat-nav or a GPS that kept deciding for you where your current location is wouldn't be very useful. A sat-nav or a GPS system that said, that current location isn't very interesting, let's put the blue dot somewhere else. Or a sat-nav system or a GPS system that said, that destination they've just logged in, I'm sure they don't really want to go there. Yes, Kidderminster is more interesting. So it needs to anchor, to lock you in. And so problem-solving mode of mind locks us in to where we want to be and where, while we're doing the task, when we finish the task, then it can wipe the slate clean and the action schema is over and we're done. But try that with our moods or our sense of self as a person and we have a problem. Many of us use the common example of trying to get to sleep. If the problem-solving mode starts up when you can't get to sleep, what happens? No thoughts come up like, you've got an important talk tomorrow. If you don't sleep, you'll be wrecked. So go to sleep now. So the problem-solving mode, the means-end thinking, it clearly doesn't work there. And the same is true for other things as well. When we're in a sad mood, if this GPS system in our head locks on, what's your destination to be happy? Where are you? What's your current location? Sad. Keep that in mind. So don't lose the idea that you're sad and you want to be happy. The general sense of that is you feel less happy. But the doing mode is so automatic, it volunteers so skillfully and silently for this job that we don't see it happening. Luckily, there are several signs that it's happening, but we need to learn to monitor them, to see them clearly. And what happens in an 8-week course is week by week, a different aspect of the doing mode is featured. Automatic pilot, living in our head. As a feature, the mind being scattered and always going to past and future in session 3, failure to recognize aversion in session 4, and really bringing that up so we can see it clearly, the tendency we have to push away what we don't want in session 5 is brought into focus so we can learn to allow it, to see it clearly, to turn towards it using the body by then. To see thoughts, as mental events in session 6. And to realize in session 7 that the doing mode, if left to itself, would make us strive and strive until we were exhausted, never taking any rest at all. And so deliberately turning towards that aspect and putting nourishing rather than depleting actions into our day. So step by step, looking at different signs of doing, and allowing ourselves to see it clearly, and then relate differently to what's going on. And with that, not necessarily instant relaxation, but a little bit more freedom, a little bit more room for maneuver. Well, as Willem has already said, we published the book of the manual in 2002, Mindfulness-Based Cognitive Therapy for Depression. And we thought it would occupy a very small corner of the clinical psychology psychotherapy field, because we'd said in that book that if you wanted to teach this stuff, what we had learned ourselves, the hard way, I have to say, in my case, was that you have to practice in order to enable others to practice. And practice is hard. And also, how many clinical psychologists would want to learn to meditate and practice in order to do this therapy? How many of them already had some experience at working with cognitive therapy anyway, and then would want to learn to do this, and then would know enough about groups to be able to handle a class? So when you put all those Venn diagrams and overlap, you get about three people in the world, and we thought we were the only three. But nevertheless, Guilford thought there might be a fourth person somewhere, so they published a book. And it turned out to be, for reasons I don't really understand, actually, it turned out to be really quite engaging for people. Still, I don't really understand it. It may have been the cognitive science aspect. It may have been that people were looking for something more than therapy. But nevertheless, the other trials that were done based on that manual seemed to show, yes, that it does have, just across the board for people with three or more episodes of depression, reducing the risk of depression over the next 12 months by about a third. But having this interesting finding as well that for the people who are the most severely depressed, who've been depressed for longest or have an abuse history, it seems to work even better, over around and over 50% reduction in relapse. And in 2013 or 14, there was a second edition. And there we had the chance to clarify things, to clarify where compassion fitted in, for example. There's a new chapter on that. To clarify the importance of the three-minute breathing space as the spine of the program into which the longer formal practices are folded, or the learning from those longer practices are folded into a breathing space. A chapter on inquiry and the sense of dialogue that happens that continues the meditation into an examination and exploration of the phenomenology of mind and body, a sharing together in the class of what's going on, and whatever's going on, what happened next, how we're reacting and relating to what's going on, and how we can be then invited to incorporate that into further practice at home and in the session. That process of inquiry, a new chapter on that. But also being more explicit in session six on thoughts are not facts. Why have a whole session on it when we've been doing nothing but that in some senses, right from the raisin practice in the very first one? We talk there about mind wandering. We talk in the body scan about mind wandering. In session two, we have walking down the street and noticing what happens in your mind if somebody doesn't see you and doesn't acknowledge you, that you think should have at least waved. So we've talked about thoughts there. We've talked about how the mind is grabbed into the past and into the future in session three. In session four, we have a sounds and thoughts meditation from the Jon Kabat-Zinn MBSR that focuses on thoughts. So why in session six do we want to revisit it? Partly because it's so central that it needs to be revisited again and again, but partly because thoughts often come in disguise. That sense of that John Kabat-Zinn had, that the thoughts in chronic pain don't announce themselves as thoughts. In fact, when we sit, the thoughts that are least likely to announce themselves are those that have an affective charge. Those thoughts that, as it were, come from behind, like the whisper in the cinema. Those thoughts when you're sitting, like, you're not very good at this, or this is going well, enlightenment today, or I'm bored now, what's the time? Perhaps it's tea time. Joseph Goldstein, the meditation teacher at IMS, tells the story of the early days when he was sitting in India, and very great enthusiasm at that time, sitting with Burmese teachers in India. And it was one of those days when the meditation was going well. He says that in that context, there wasn't a lot of food each day. There was a sort of chapati and a small banana for lunch. But this morning, the meditation was going so well, he thought, noticed the thought, this is it. He'd read about, heard about enlightenment. This is it. This is it. And then the thought came, it's lunchtime. And the way he describes it is beautiful. Banana, enlightenment. Banana, enlightenment. And the banana won. There's a sense in which the thoughts that are closest to home are most in disguise. And one of the things that we wanted to really emphasize all the way through is how hard it is to do this work. If it was easy, you could just sit for 10 minutes and you go, oh, fantastic. Right, I'm now free of my thoughts and all my moods. It's hard, partly because these things come in disguise. We don't see the voice telling us that actually we should give up now, we're no good, we'll never make it. And even if you've been practicing 20 or 30 years, often what happens is you become more sensitive to these thoughts, so you actually think you're making no progress at all. That the sense is of, oh, you know, why do I still get drawn in? Why do I still get irritable? Why do I still say silly things to people I love? Why does that keep happening? It's because that keeps happening that we keep practicing. That's why we call it practice. And in the three-minute breathing space, which becomes for people the small meditation that enables them to make all this portable, it starts with acknowledging. It starts with seeing clearly. In the last book that we put together, and I guess it will be our last, the Mindful Way workbook that John Teasdale took responsibility for writing, he developed a sort of text message approach. You may have seen it, where the participant asks a question, the teacher gives an answer, and it's in a sort of a text format. It's really, really helpful format to have come up with, I think. And on page 100, there's some questions about the breathing space. And they're really the best description of why the breathing space has three steps that I've ever seen. The sense of needing to spend a moment acknowledging where you are right now before you narrow down to the breath. I invite you to read it. The gathering, the sense of gathering, not before you've seen clearly what's going on in your mind. And over this week, over this day, we'll be doing this sense of seeing clearly before we gather. We'll be doing some gathering and meditation, but also quite a lot of words and understanding and concepts and so on to help us see clearly what's going on in our mind. John is going to be talking after the break, and then Zindel later on, and then we'll have a panel of all three of us, which chaired by Becca Crane. And that will set off, as it were, this week from the point of seeing what's going on in mind and body, trying to understand it deeply so that later on in the week we can begin to gather ourselves and then towards the end of the week open ourselves to go out. That sense of the three aspects of the breathing space can be our sense of three aspects for this week. And my wish and my hope for you is that you just have a good time and relax and enjoy each other's company and enjoy Oxford. Thank you and welcome here.